Ebert review Michael Caine and Steve Martin as a couple of Riviera con men in Dirty Rotten Scoundrels. Danny DeVito and Arnold Schwarzenegger are a set of unlikely twins. And Kim Basinger has some surprises in store for Dan Aykroyd in My Stepmother is an Alien. It's all coming up next on Siskel and Ebert.
Find a woman, set a price, and the first man to extract the correct amount from her wins.
Michael Caine and Steve Martin are two con men who try to con each other without being conned themselves in a new comedy named Dirty Rotten Scoundrels. It's one of the new holiday movies we're going to be reviewing this week on Siskel and Ebert. And I'm Roger Ebert of the Chicago Sun-Times.
And I'm Gene Siskel of the Chicago Tribune. A lot of comedies this week. Our first one is called Dirty Rotten Scoundrels, starring Steve Martin. And Michael Caine plays a sophisticated con man posing as an aristocrat. Steve Martin plays a lower-class American charlatan. Both men like bilking women out of money. Caine works out of southern France. And when he finds Martin is working his territory, he arranges to have Steve Martin arrested, which leads to a jail scene, a funny one, where Martin tries to remember the name of the one person he knows in town, Lawrence Jameson. That's the Michael Caine character.
I know somebody here. I met him on a train. His name is... James Josephson. Lawrence Fells. Lawrence Fangs. Forrest Lawrenceton.
That's a funny bit. Eventually, the two men start working together in an uneasy peace, pretending to be brothers. Caine takes the lead.
Not mother?
No, Ruprecht. She's not our mother. Go on, Diana. You were saying?
Well, I think that the... Ah!
Ruprecht!
May I take your trident, sir?
Now, Diana, as you were saying, you don't think the poor should be allowed in museums.
I think the
Ruprecht,
poor...
Ruprecht, don't take the cork off the fork.
Why is the cork on the fork?
To prevent him hurting himself and others.
Caine still wants to get rid of Martin, so he arranges a bet. Whoever fails to bilk a visiting rich American woman has to leave town.
Done. Who's the woman?
Yes, monsieur.
Who is that?
Miss Janet Colgate, monsieur.
Who is she?
I believe she is the United States soap queen.
That's Glenn Headley as the wealthy lady. As for the movie, Caine and Martin are individually funnier than the material they've been given. For all of the trickery, we can easily see where this film is going. Still, there are individual big laughs to be had. But it's less of a movie and more of a one-man show, if you follow what I'm saying. It's a close call. But I'm voting thumbs down.
I'm voting thumbs up, Gene, but I think I know what you mean about the plot. In other words, what this plot really needed was the cleverness of a movie like The Sting.
Oh, of course.
Which totally baffles you, because the movie pretends that it's surprising you with all of these reverses, and it really isn't. So you're right about that. It doesn't fool you, but I still think that that doesn't matter that much because Martin and Caine are so funny, and especially, I mean... In a movie like this, Caine is perfectly cast because he makes such a good rogue. He's the one who's always kind of over on the side looking at everyone with that superior smile and figuring the odds. Well, Martin is more of the kind of outgoing, less subtle sort of American character. I'm not talking about his acting, but about his character. The two of them together create a real nice chemistry.
Steve Martin is a wonderful clown. I don't think there is chemistry, and that's where the lack of a plot really hurts. because I don't find them interacting. What I find them is two individual performances stuck in a bad script.
Well,
two excellent performances.
But I think that here you have two con men, and of course con men are loners. They shouldn't become buddies. I mean, they're in competition.
But they should be in competition in some interesting, connected way. And you knew, as you said, you could figure it out where it was going.
Well, still, I liked it. I enjoyed it. I thought it was funny. Okay, next movie, and our next movie is Tequila Sunrise, a film about two old friends who find themselves on opposite sides of both the law and the same woman. The movie stars Mel Gibson as a former drug dealer who has stopped dealing, or so he says, and Kurt Russell is a narcotics agent who thinks Gibson may be ready for one last big deal. In a drug bust early in the movie, the two men level with each other.
You set me up, Nick. Not tonight, pal.
Russell falls in love with Michelle Pfeiffer as a local restaurant owner. She's attracted to him, but she has problems with his style.
What is it, Nick? You need some chapstick or some lip gloss or something? Because your lips keep getting stuck on your teeth. Or is that your idea of a smile?
On the other hand, she's also attracted to the shyness and the honesty of Mel Gibson.
Okay. So he's your lawyer and he's my lawyer. What does that do for you?
Look, I pretty much knew that you knew what I'd done for a living, and I wanted him to let you know that I now had a legitimate business. Naturally, I didn't want him busted in the meantime.
So he thought that Andy Leonard would give you respectability?
Yes, ma'am.
Well, what do you need it for?
You.
Finally, inevitably, the two men arrive at a big showdown.
I want to get this straight. You kill me over drug money?
Well, it's a lot of money. What's it going to be, Nick?
There is some good acting in Tequila Sunrise by Gibson, by Russell, and also by Michelle Pfeiffer, and there's some very good dialogue written by Robert Towne, who wrote and directed the movie. Some of the individual scenes in this film play with real power and style, but the movie as a whole doesn't hold together. It's too confusing, and some of the key scenes in the movie seem to be missing. We're wondering whether maybe we didn't, you know, miss something that we should have known about, and we realize, no, it's not there. We never know for sure if Gibson is still a drug dealer, for example, or if he isn't, and even if that's not important, we also get lost in the chronology of the film. We don't always know what's happening or why or how some of the other characters know things they shouldn't know or turn up at places they shouldn't know about. Tequila Sunrise is a case of style in search of substance, a good-looking movie that just doesn't hold together.
It held together long enough for me to like it. I agree with you at the end. When there are so many double crosses back and forth, finally you say, I give up, because it's not any fun anymore. But till it reaches that point, I'd say about two-thirds of the picture I thought were fascinating. Robert Towne wrote Chinatown. This has some kind of complexity as that film. The performances, as you said, are uniformly very, very good. I'd rather see a flawed film where the people are acting at the top of their form and saying interesting things and being a little bit lifelike in the sense that things aren't always clear. And it's in the shadow world of narcotics and detectives in L.A. and fancy restaurants and all this. I liked that I couldn't figure it out. That was fun for me. That's a rare kind of a thing. Then it just got too confusing, I think, for its own good. But most of the way, I like the picture.
Well, you know, some of the dialogue was particularly well written. It's so rare when you have people in the movies who are really talking intelligently in clever and witty ways. So much modern American Hollywood dialogue is flat. Yeah. It's just information. It's just talking.
Right.
And in the old days, people talked with more style and wit, and Towne does that for his characters
here. Now, look at these two films here. You're almost rewarding Dirty Rotten Scoundrels for aiming low and hitting it partly.
I'm not aiming it. I was thinking to myself as you were giving Tequila Sunrise a pass, you were doing what you always accuse me of, which is finding a facet in a movie that you like.
There are many facets. The facets are the three performances and all of the dialogue.
Okay, so you just like the two performances and all of the dialogue in Dirty Rotten Scoundrels. You said you did.
Not all of the dialogue, because I don't like the plot. The plot doesn't work. Here the plot tips off at the end.
So,
just at the end.
Yeah, so you're actually contradicting yourself.
No, I'm not contradicting myself.
Oh, yes, you are.
No. I think the fact that you want to remember here is to see Tequila Sunrise before Dirty Rotten Scoundrels. Coming up next, twins, and they're not identical. Danny DeVito and Arnold Schwarzenegger co-star.
Who are you?
Oh, I'm Vincent's brother.
We're twins.
twins, which has a marvelous concept. Why not cast Danny DeVito and Arnold Schwarzenegger as twins? Why not? I mean, that sounds like a good idea. They supposedly were formed in a genetic experiment to make the ideal baby. Things went about half right. The boys were separated at birth. Schwarzenegger was raised as a perfect, good-hearted specimen on a South Sea island. He goes off in search of his twin, DeVito, who plays a lowlife who steals cars to make ends meet in Los Angeles. And he doesn't realize, DeVito doesn't realize, that he has a twin brother. Here's where Schwarzenegger visits DeVito in jail, intending to bail him out.
I have looked for this...
You gotta talk into the phone, bozo.
Vincent. Dearest Vincent, I know you don't know who I am, but believe me, I came halfway across the world.
I got another 6 hours to pay the money back. And tell the Klain brothers that harassing a man who's already in the slammer is beneath even them, all right?
I don't know any Klain brothers. I'm your brother, Julius.
Huh? Come again?
My name is Julius, and I'm your twin brother.
Oh, obviously. The moment I sat down, I thought I was looking into a mirror.
DeVito is obviously more worldly wise than Schwarzenegger, teaching him, for example, how to seduce women by dancing.
I hope nobody's looking in the window. Here, come on, like this. Here you go. Put your feet by my feet. Come on. Let's go. Here. By my feet, not on my feet. Oh, thanks very much.
Sorry, Vincent.
Minor oversight there. Okay, all right, grab my hand. Come on. Yeah. Ah, ah, ease up, tiny bit. Let the blood flow through the fingers.
They are very funny together. This film presents each man with a romantic situation. Here is Schwarzenegger's as he tries to deal with a seduction by actress Kelly Preston.
Which bed should I take?
Either bed will be fine. I always sleep on the floor.
The opening hour of Twins is extremely funny in concept and in execution. The comedy runs downhill a little bit as this film inevitably gives us an action sequence toward the conclusion. I wish the writers would have just left these two talented performers alone with each other more often. But on balance, Twins is mostly a success. Here's the third film where I'm in the middle, and I'm giving this one a pass.
Yeah, I give this one, I'm also giving this one thumbs up. This is the third film about two guys who are buddies, for that matter, if you want to get into that, where they get the kind of casting of point and counterpoint here. What could be more point counterpoint than Arnold Schwarzenegger or Danny DeVito, and they are very funny at the beginning. My heart sank a little bit at the end, too, when they got involved with that plot about the contraband industrial espionage.
Why?
Because I thought, why do they always have to have an ending that involves a shootout and a chase? We've talked about this week after week after week after week. Writers give up two-thirds of the way through and cut to the chase. But here, they don't really go all the way. They come back and they...
Something else,
it's not just an action ending, and so that's a good thing.
When they came back to something else, I was pleased. But we ought to just have like a little button that we push, which was no third act, no third act. And then the viewer could get on with the next review.
Our reviews seem to be... sometimes week after week the same thing, but then the movies sometimes week after week are the same thing. Coming up next, Kim Basinger and Dan Aykroyd in a comedy about sex and flying saucers named My Stepmother is an Alien.
I have to change. This is inappropriate.
Oh, might I suggest a more conventional spot? Like, backseat of my car.
Comedy named My Stepmother is an Alien, and it stars Dan Aykroyd as a scientist who harnesses the power of lightning. And that's what they're always doing in the movies. They're always harnessing the power of lightning, one of those great catchphrases. He harnesses this power to send a signal to outer space, and in response, he inspires a visit to Earth by a flying saucer, and out of the saucer and into his life walks an alien who takes the very human form of Kim Basinger. She turns up for the first time at a beachfront party where she knows a little bit about a lot of things, but she doesn't exactly fit in. Basinger's mission is to convince Aykroyd to repeat his experiment, and right from the first, she seems to have the correct approach.
Oh, for an astronomer, you have the most wonderful fibers.
And you got yourself a handful right now.
Basinger's all-purpose survival kit is a miraculous purse that seems able to do almost anything.
Excuse me, but I'm from DARPA, the Defense Advanced Research Project Agency, with instructions to tour this facility, so
can I see some ID?
My Stepmother Is an Alien starts with a promising idea, but it never really goes anywhere with it. Time after time in this movie, it sets up a comic scene and then doesn't really pay it off or have the nerve to really take it over the top. Most of the elements in the movie seem to have been reassembled from spare parts from other movies. And the best thing in the film is Kim Basinger's inspired performance, the physical performance, especially the physical side of this performance, because she's good at slapstick and she's good at walking around as if her body doesn't fit, seems to be operating the controls with her elbows, kind of reminded me of Starman, the great Jeff Bridges performance. There are times here when she's so funny you wonder why the movie itself seems to be holding back from her funniness. One of the elements that holds it back is Dan Aykroyd, who is given a juicy role as a mad scientist, but then relegated to the role of straight man in this movie. Basically just sets up the jokes for her. My Stepmother Is an Alien is a great title, but that's when the inspiration seems to have run out.
I liked more of it than you did. You've neglected to mention, I think, one of the funniest characters in the film, which is John Lovitz, who from Saturday Night Live, the guy who always plays a liar character on that show, who is very funny as the older, wealthier brother of Aykroyd and the very jealous brother of Aykroyd when he finds out who Aykroyd is living
with. I didn't mention John Lovitz because I didn't find that that character was amusing in any way. I thought he was just obnoxious character now, not John Lovitz. Every time he came on the screen, well, I couldn't wait for him to disappear.
He's supposed to be obnoxious, and I think he is funny in doing so. And I also, I think you're a little rough on Aykroyd. Kim Basinger was very funny. This picture is not the greatest comedy. We haven't had a picture here that's been a complete success, but I thought that the writing, and particularly involving the daughter, who you did mention, I thought that the writing was a little bit brighter than I expected. Sure, this is a little bit of Ghostbusters redo. I see a little bit of that stuff with special effects and lightning and all that, and Aykroyd again, and partners working on this extraterrestrial kind of story, but I thought that it was funny enough, and I laughed at it.
I'm actually giving it a pass.
Yeah, I liked it. Coming up next, Roger and I are going to look at a couple of our favorite home videos starring Arnold Schwarzenegger and Danny DeVito, the twins on tape.
Aunt Sadie, it's Harry Valentini, your nephew from Newark. Guess what? We're coming to Atlantic City.
With the tremendous publicity surrounding Twins, Roger and I thought we'd devote our video segment to looking over the film careers of Danny DeVito and Arnold Schwarzenegger and recommend one of their better but lesser-known films. My favorite film that Schwarzenegger has appeared in is still his film debut, playing a muscle man pretty much like himself in love with Sally Field in Stay Hungry.
Look at this people. Now this is what you call class. How are you, Mary Kate?
Excuse me, I got a relative to say hi. I'll be right back.
Uncle Albert.
So, good evening, sir.
What's the matter with you, baby?
Well, don't you think this dress is a little bit out of place?
Even there, 12 years ago, you can see the sense of humor that separates Schwarzenegger from so many action heroes and accounts for a lot of his success. Stay Hungry is a fascinating, quirky film, and the casting of Schwarzenegger was inspired. This is one that I would rent.
That's a movie that really could be on one of our shows about buried treasure.
Oh,
nobody
absolutely.
Has heard of it. Nobody remembers it. At the time, it was a jewel that was absolutely, completely entertaining, and people just didn't... It
one of Sally Field's best performances.
Yes,
too.
It was. Yeah. Go ahead. Yeah. So you picked Schwarzenegger on video. I'm going to pick one by Danny DeVito, and this is probably his most unfairly overlooked performance in a movie that I still think was hilarious from beginning to end. It didn't do business, didn't get good reviews. I don't know why. You liked it too. It's called Wise Guys, and it stars DeVito and Joe Piscopo as a couple of low-rent mobsters who always get the bad jobs until a string of incredible mistakes and a little good luck lead them all the way to the top.
This gentleman and I would like the biggest and best suite you have.
How would you like to pay for this?
Yes, that's right.
Quickly. Take it out of there. That's fine. A gold card.
Yes, I believe I've seen them before. Thank you, Mr. Acavado.
Resorts International.
Would you get that in the glove compartment?
What I like about DeVito in almost all of his roles is that he never seems to be playing only for comedy. There's always a human being inside, even his most outrageous characters, and that touch of humanity makes him more fallible and therefore more funny.
This is an absolutely wonderful film. I gave it 4 stars. It was on, I think, one of my top 10 lists or very close to it that year. The only explanation that I've ever heard why it isn't a big success is that people said there's just too much screaming in it. Well, I like the fact that this film was played at the top register in volume between the people and then got louder. I mean, these are mobsters after all. They're not known necessarily for subtlety.
Well, you know, one of the, now we look at all of these movies this week that have two guys in them and are comedies, like Twins and like Dirty Rotten Scoundrels.
Right.
The fact is, if you really want to get down to it, Wise Guys is funnier than
Wise Guys is a funnier film, and if you want a guy and a woman in it, stay hungry. Okay, now let's recap the movies we reviewed on this show. A split decision on Dirty Rotten Scoundrels. I like Steve Martin and Michael Caine individually, but hated the contrived plot. Roger felt the two stars were able to carry the movie. Another split vote on Tequila Sunrise. We both agree that the film's plot is overly complicated, but I enjoyed the mystery more than Roger. Two thumbs up for Twins, with the great casting of Danny DeVito and Arnold Schwarzenegger. Another split vote on another comedy, My Stepmother is an Alien. We both enjoyed Kim Basinger's performance, but I was the only one who liked the work of Dan Aykroyd and John Lovitz. My thumb up, Roger's down. So the one that we both agree on is Twins with
Danny DeVito. Also think Dirty Rotten Scoundrels is funnier than you get credit for.
Okay, and I like the writing of Tequila Sunrise and the three leads.
Okay, that's it for this week. Next time we'll be back with reviews of more holiday movies, including Rain Man, about two very different brothers, played by Dustin Hoffman and Tom Cruise. And we'll also review Working Girl with Melanie Griffith as a secretary trying to get ahead on Wall Street while competing with Sigourney Weaver and conspiring with Harrison Ford. That's next week, and until then, the balcony is closed.
Raisinettes and Goobers are playing everywhere, starring plump, juicy raisins and great golden peanuts. Both now feature creamy Nestle milk chocolate. Sony videotapes. For taping your favorite movies, trust Sony Dynamicron ES. Whatever your videotape needs, there's only one name to play back, Sony. After work or after workout, Daisy Turbo Spa combines powerful water massage and tingling aeration to turn your tub into a personal whirlpool. What's great for kids and parents? A bucket full of Duplo blocks and Lego bricks. Now you can store the toys that build great imaginations.